Okay. Oh, it's a delay. Sorry. Yes. Okay, welcome. I'll just start the recording also. Perfect. So, everyone, welcome to Ashes Corner. Today we will listen to Barbara Forbes talk about DevOps for the IT pro. But since we're not doing the regular meetups, we have a bit broader audience, I hope. I just want to tell you a little bit about what this meetup is. It's called Ashes Corner, and currently we are 820 members plus. It's all about learning, networking, and have fun. And that's challenging today, of course, since situation is different than it used to be. The Ashes Corner crew is us four that you see on the screen now. Johan, Magnus, Robin, and me, and we try to make this fun and inspire people to do cool stuff with Azure. So, to the people joining that's not usually in Sweden or Malmö or Skåne, this is where Skåne is. It's in the southern part of Sweden, and we are connected to Denmark with a bridge. Just a note, we have our own flag, and it's not used too much. Some things Skåne is famous about, and here it's actually should be like this. We have a turning torso bridge, so turning torso building, very let's say cool building, but pretty useless, I've heard from people living there. We have a really cool, useful bridge that connects us to Denmark. As you can see, we drive under the water for 3 kilometers. Currently, at night, it's lit up in solidarity because we're fighting this pandemic together. Zlatan is from Malmö, Skåne. And we also produce Absolut Vodka in Skåne. Everyone should know about that. So, if you join this session, please share on social media with Ashes Corner hashtag. We try to gather all of our stuff there. And as a token of your interest, Microsoft has produced these digital badges. You can claim them by scanning a QR code that I will show on the next slide. We will come back to this at the end of the session also, so you don't have to hurry up and try and think that you missed it. You should download this Engine wallet, and then you scan the code, QR code, and then you can claim one of these. Actually, it's none of those. It's one of, one of the badges. And if you collect many of these, you can actually look it up on web. And eventually, when we get together and can go on online conferences, we can go to a Microsoft booth and showcase that you have many of these. And then they'll give you some cool swag. I think that's the idea. We want to thank our host, Fou Café. That's where we are now. We're not so many people here. We have four. Three that manages the stream and one that's attending. But hopefully more people are online. Of course, Microsoft is sponsoring this, so thanks to them. Short agenda, introductions and welcome. That wasn't intended for the on-site people, but we did it online also. We're gonna listen to Barbara on about the DevOps for IT Pro. We will have a short Q&A. So for everyone online, please type in your questions in the stream on YouTube. I will gather them and I will present them to Barbara after her session. And use Ashes Corner hashtag if you do it via Twitter or LinkedIn or any other places. I just want to mention that next event will be 1st December. It's about Azure Virtual Vaughan and Firewall, how you build and manage networks at global scale. We have a speaker, Martin Persson. He's from Atea, a solution architect. And the location will be same, similar. Hopefully, the regulations say that we can be more than 8 people or not, we'll see. But we will do it as a hybrid event, so it will be streamed online also. And also upcoming, I just want to mention this because we are planning it at the moment, some hands-on skill-up sessions on 2 to 4 occasions. It might be that they are certification preparation format in collaboration with Microsoft. So that's something that we are working on. So join the meetup, sign up, and you will get notified when that happens. And with that said, let's get started and get Barbara online. I'll stop presenting and hopefully you can start present, Barbara.
Yes, I will start. All right, I'll shut down the stream because it's only gonna confuse me. And we're just gonna assume that everyone can hear us. Hi, everyone. So I want to talk today about Azure DevOps for the IT Pro. Now, normally I'd like to do talks in a big theater and ask some questions, things like that. Well, that's a bit harder now, but I want to try one thing. If people are watching on YouTube, can you say in the chat whether you would consider yourself a developer or an IT pro? Just because I'm always curious. I am going to see it in the end, so I'm not going to act on it. But I do think it's a fun question to see what audience comes to this. So let us know in the chat on YouTube. My name is Barbara Forbes, and I'm an IT consultant. I work at SCCT in the Netherlands. I'm also an MCT and an Azure MVP. I work with Azure, and I focus myself on automating Azure, so PowerShell stuff and infrastructure as code, and of course Azure DevOps. And I write a blog post on that at forbeswith4.nl. And you can find me on Twitter at BA4BES if you want to follow me or send me a message. So we're going to talk DevOps today, and we're going to talk Azure DevOps. But you can't talk about Azure DevOps if you do not consider what DevOps actually is. And I thought, well, I must not be the first person who's asking this question. So let's hit up our favorite resource on the internet, Wikipedia, and see what they say on DevOps. And I found this definition. This is a literal screenshot from Wikipedia. And I laughed out loud at the fact that there are 4 different sources to cite that we do not have a definition for DevOps. So I got nowhere, and I looked again, and I ended up on the Microsoft docs. There are very extensive documentation on DevOps and Azure DevOps. And I found this definition by Donovan Brown, which I will say out loud, which is: DevOps is the union of people, process, and products to enable continuous delivery of value to our end users. And one reason I know this is a very good definition is because I think I've seen it in every DevOps talk that I've seen. Somewhere at some point, this definition is mentioned. And I think it really describes the process very well. And what I personally like a lot is that it talks about the delivery of value. It doesn't talk about delivering software or delivering code. No, it's delivering value. And if you're on the IT pro side of things, then you're also delivering value, and DevOps might help your work process. Now, take it back to the actual process. This is the DevOps circle or DevOps loop, if you will. There are a few different kinds of these loops with different colors and a few different birds. And this is one that I made myself based on another one. But they all follow basically the same steps between dev and ops. But what I would like to consider is how this can have a place in a typical IT pro work for an IT pro, something that an IT pro would do. And I want to consider if you have an environment and you need to create a new application server. Could be a few reasons for that. Maybe you're creating it in Azure and you're migrating from on-prem to Azure. Maybe you already have it in Azure, but you want to do an update and you work with InfraS Code or not, but you want to create a new server. Or maybe it's all happening on premises. And you have to create a new server over there. And when we create an application server, what the first thing we would do is plan the change that we're going to do. This might mean we create a bit of a plan of what steps do we have to take, but you will also plan how many people do I need for that? How many hours might it take, more or less? Do we have the knowledge to do that? Do we need to reserve time to educate each other? What parties are involved? Who is going to get upset if we change something on that application, if we migrate something? These are all steps that if you're an IT pro of the classical kind, you probably have thought about at one point or another. And after you plan this, the next step, it says code, but you could also call it create. So this would be where you create that server. Let's assume this is a virtual machine running, you're using infrastructure as a service, or you're running on premises. And you need to create that virtual machine and make sure it meets your company's requirements. So there's a backup plan and malware protection, stuff like that. Maybe you already need to install something for the application. Something is requested by the development team, stuff like that. But you create that whole server. After that is done, in the circle it says the build stage. And this is a pretty tricky one because build really counts on an application. And we do not really have a build step when you're an IT pro, but we do have the build and test phase. So if we pull them together, you always do some testing before you set the server to production. So you might look at your stakeholders and see if they're still up to date. You might have a pilot user group or a development application that you put out there first to test it. And these are all steps that you take at this point. This is also where you would inform your help desk that there's a change going to be coming. You make sure that maintenance window is still available. You prepare everything for that release. And then a release step comes, and with an application server, you would deploy that application to that server and make sure that server is completely ready to start running. After that comes, at the end of the release step, is where you would change the DNS records and make sure that the application is actually running and your new application is running production. And then start to operate, and this is where you find out all the things that you have forgotten in the plan stage. So things happen, things are not what you were expected, users might find bugs, things like that happens, but it could also be that this just is the point where your application needs new features. Maybe the amount of users increases and you need to add more resources, stuff like that. So you start that operating stream and you monitor that to find out how it is running and if some new action need to be taken. And for example, if you find, well, this server is starting to get slow, we need more resources, from that point you can start running in through that plan stage again and start planning the phase to start new resources. Now, this is a pretty large example. This is not something you do every day, deploy a new application server with this whole process. What you can actually do is divide that whole process in all these little steps. So with your planning stage, you might start with a proof of concept and you run the whole circle for that proof of concept. Or you might even start with setting up the infrastructure as code to create that server, and you run the whole stage again. But you can use this circle for everything. If you want to change two lines of code, the circle can really help you to keep track of how you're working. But my point in this is that it's very applicable to work that an IT pro might do. So that's DevOps. And what is Azure DevOps, if we're talking on that? Azure DevOps is tooling that can help you with that circle. It can help you run that process with a team or on your own and use automation and get interfaces that can help you. And we're going to walk through all those. One interesting thing to know about Azure DevOps, and first I'm going to move to this one. This is an Azure DevOps overview, and the first thing you might notice is that you see the things in the menu. The menu items are the same as the ones we saw in the circle, more or less, where the boards are for your plan stage, the repos are for your code staging, and the pipelines can help you with build, test, and release. And there are more options within an Azure DevOps project, but to keep it all a bit simple, we'll focus on these options. And what you do, you work in a project and you get all those resources available. What I want to mention is that Azure DevOps, if you start out with it, is completely free. And you do not even need an Office 365 license. You can do this on a personal Microsoft account or in a business Microsoft account. And you can start running this without any licensing whatsoever. And if you are running your own Azure DevOps organization, you get 6 users for free every month. And after that, you start paying for the users. I think it's €6 a month. It might have changed since then, since I last checked. You also get benefits from Visual Studio Enterprise. So it's all pretty available, and it's really available to get started with it because you do not have to pay anything. You do not need a license, and you can do it in your work account or in your personal account. With your work account, though, it is possible for your administrator to block you from doing that. So if it's not working, try your personal Microsoft account. It will work just as well. So you might be thinking now, how do I get me one of those? Because it's free and it's supposed to be easy. And well, the rest of the talk will focus on how happy it's going to make you. And I want to show you that. And I made a quick video because if I did this live, I already have like 5 different organizations. And I think it's enough. So let's hope it is running. This is what you get if you go to dev.azure.com. And as you can see, you can start for free. And that one I forgot to mention, you can actually do it with your GitHub account as well. As you see here, you can sign in with GitHub. You do not need a Microsoft account. But we're going to create a Microsoft account we're going to use here. And this is an account that I created for this. It does not have a license or anything. So I sign in like I would if I signed up in Azure. And now it asks me just one question. Where do I live? Or where am I from? This is because the resources are actually created next to in the region where you live. So I live in the Netherlands and I use the Netherlands. This means also that pretty much all the resources, there are some exclusions, are stored in your own region. So pretty nice. And this is how fast it goes. I did not speed this up in any way. This is how fast it is. And I now have my own Azure DevOps with the beautiful name of Demo09L16, but I can change that if I want, and I can create a project here. And I can choose if I want that public or private. Public is visible for anyone on the internet, so it could help with an open source project. But if you're starting out, you're creating your own script, I suggest you choose a private project, and you can have this in your Azure environment and have permissions that way. And here we go. We have a complete project. And this is how long it takes to create your own Azure DevOps. So if you, after this talk and after the questions go to dev.azure.com, you can have your own Azure DevOps running before you start dinner. So now that we've got our own Azure DevOps, time to start working with it. So let's look at some of the options that you have available from Azure DevOps. And we're going to start with the plan phase, because that's the first thing that we're going to do. We're going to plan a change or a feature or to fix a bug. Now, I was thinking the boards, how am I going to describe what is available? And I wanted to call it some kind a sort of to-do list. But I'm afraid that people who are very good at agile will get a bit pissed off with me. So I call it this like a to-do list, except that it's not. And it is more than a to-do list. It is very, very extensive. There's a lot of possibility. But if you're starting out, it's fine to just think of it like a to-do list. Now, we have a few different options available. The work items where we can see every work item, and the backlogs where we can see all the work items. I'm going to focus for now on the boards to keep it all a bit simple and a bit a good overview of everything. And because I think if you get started, that's the most useful feature in the boards. Boards, yeah. So as I said, this theory is based on Agile, or you can run it on Scrum. And Agile is more than a planning tool. Agile is more a philosophy. It's a process that helps you with running your teamwork, and it's got all these theories like working software is more important than comprehensive documentation, and responding to a change is more important than following a plan. And you can have a 45-minute talks about Agile. And I'm not going to do that because I want to talk about other stuff, and I'm not the best person to do that. It is good to know that this is what is behind it and to do some reading in on it if you want to use this philosophy. Or you can use the basic board. This is available since last year somewhere, where your board is just a to-do, a doing, and a done column. And I want to show real quickly, if I can find my browser, yes, I can, how this works. So here I have a to-do, doing, and done board. And if I want to do something, I can say it here, do a thing. So now I have a work item, and I can create more of them. And I can add tasks in the work item, or I can divide the work item to more than that. I can add tests to it. And what the nice thing about it is that you can say, this is the one that I'm actually doing at this time. So you know you do not have to worry about this one. You're doing this one. You can drag more of them out here, but you can drag them around. See, what am I doing? Where am I going? And if you're done, you say, I'm done. And you get a nice overview of what is actually happening and what is going on. And for example, if I draw this to doing, this is one of my favorite things. If I have a lot of items here, I now have two items, but if I have a lot of items going on, I don't really care about what has been done. I mean, it's nice to see that I've accomplished something and place a check, but I don't really care. So I can just push this and it's out of my way. I don't have to watch it. And I can actually say I'm just focusing on what I'm doing. I can't start what I have to do yet, so I can prioritize. I'm working on doing. And let's use this button, and it's out of my way. So if there's items in here, I don't have to look at it. I can focus on just what I'm doing, which brings some peace of mind. On your own or in a team, it can help you bring some peace of mind. Now, this is a basic board. You can make this as complicated or as easy as you, or as simple as you want. And I want to show you a quick example of a more complicated board. And this is by now, I think, more than a year old, maybe 2 years old. But this was at one point where I had so much stuff going on outside of work. Like I was writing blog posts, I was preparing for talks, I was had a module in the PowerShell gallery that I had to keep up to date and build features in. I had so much going on that I actually had a board to keep track of my own tech outside of work life. And it really helped me out. And as you can see here, I make extensive use of tags. So I like to color code stuff. So with the color, I could see immediately what was going on. I added some columns in there. The on hold column for me means I have to keep track of someone else taking action, but not me. I always like to have a different column for color for the resolved category, so I can see, oh, look at all the things I've done. And I'll drag them to close when a new week starts. So you see there's a lot of options. There's tasks available. And like I said, you can make this as easy or as complicated as you would like. Now, how can you get started with this? My tips are to start small. So start with that basic board if that works the best for you. Do not start colorizing everything or tagging everything before you know what's really going on, because you're going to confuse yourself one point or another. So start small and look what's available for you and look what works for you. So keep looking at your own process, what works for you, especially if you're working in a team. Find out if you're at one point saying, well, we're now dividing the tasks into two small to-dos, for example. It could be that you feel that way, or if you need an extra column, maybe you want that on hold column. Maybe it bugs you to have an on hold column. You want to do that another way. So it's good to be critical of that and only keep what works for you. There are no rules, as far as I'm concerned, on how you do this. You do this how it works for you. And when you want to start, use a personal board. You do not have to wait for your team. You can get some experience with it. And I actually really recommend to create a board with your family. I've tried to get my husband on board and he did not want to use it with me. So I had to make my own personal board. But I think you can find some blog posts somewhere online from people who have planned a move with their whole family through an Agile work process or through Azure boards. So use it for your personal life and see if it improves by that. But it can at least help you start working with the boards. So now we have planned that change, planned the code, planned whatever we're going to do. And it's time to start creating. And in Azure DevOps, that means we're going to work in the repos. Now, I'm going to take a little bit to talk about what Git is, because the repos are built on Git, which you might already also know from GitHub or GitLab or other resource or Git providers. But for people who are not familiar, I want to discuss a little bit what Git actually is. And what you see here is my representation of the situation without Git. And I know I did it like this before I used Git. We're all working on our own local computer. And from our own local environment, we're throwing resources out into the universe. So we're doing stuff with our on-premise environment. We're changing things in Azure AD. We're managing automation accounts or function apps. We're creating resources with infrastructure as code, all from our own local computer. And you might deploy it through to a script server or to a file share that you have somewhere, but you always do the work locally. This means it gets very hard to have some kind of versioning and backup on your code, because you don't know at what point something changed, especially if you're working with more than one person on that code. And I think we all are familiar with that phase where you create a script. So you call it script, and then you're scared that you're going to change something that you're going to need later. So you create script 2, copy of that, change that, and then you change it to script 3. And before you know it, you have script 15, script final, no, really, script final, final, final. We've all been there, and it gets messy pretty fast. Another thing that happens when you're in a team is environment inconsistency. And this can really mess up your code at one point or another. For example, if one person is working with a different version of a PowerShell module than another person, you get inconsistency. But this can even go as far as I remember when we're working Terraform with the whole team, that once someone updated Terraform on the local computer, none of the other people could deploy to Terraform until they updated. So we had to coordinate with each other when we're going to update. It's pretty hard to get some error handling and code review in here. It's hard to work together on code if it's on your local machine. As you all know, you cannot send PowerShell code scripts, for example, through email. So you call it script.txt and then someone has to change it again. We've all been there and it's not the most handy way to go, especially since that file script final 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 is now called script final 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 with review. And lastly, it's hard to do auditing. It's hard to keep track of which person did what change to what script. So you have auditing in your live environment, but you do not know where your script is coming from, who changed what line, and what script was the base for what is now running in production. So these are the problems. Now let's see what solutions Git can give you. When you're running Git, as you see here, you got the providers in the middle. That's where your scripts live. And you are committing your scripts to your Git provider, and your colleagues are as well. So you're working from one base with your whole team. This means that you get that code versioning and backup out there. So Git always keeps copies of your old code. You will always see a complete lineup of the history of your code. So that can help you out. This is also makes it easier if you use pull requests to have code reviews or have some error handling. And you can see who changed codes and who's changed certain lines of code. So this can help you out to get it all a bit more professional. And I will say at this point, I am not able to explain Git in this one little talk because otherwise it would take a lot longer. But this is just to get a grasp of the concept of Git. And what do you use that for as an IT pro? Because we're not developers for IT pro. We do not program, but we do work with code. I think for the IT pro, the code everyone probably thinks of the first is PowerShell. If you're not using PowerShell, you should start using PowerShell. It's an amazing tool, especially for the IT pro, for management of Azure, of Windows Surface, and it works on Linux now, it works on Mac, and this is one of the first things I would think about. But we also have infrastructure as a code, and this can make your life a lot easier as well. And for this example, I say ARM templates or Terraform, stuff like that, is also code and something that you want to keep track of and store. But if we take it all the way, who hasn't had a batch script in their environment? I know I've had them and I wasn't happy about it. Maybe you had a login script, stuff like that. I think we can agree this is all legacy, but if you have them in your environment and it's running production somewhere, you might as well store it in a safe place where you can keep track of it, do some quality control and know what versioning is going on. Some things that can help you out when you're using specifically Azure DevOps, the repos. As you can see, you have the standard things that you have with Git, with is that versioning and branches. You also have branch policies and security, so you can, for example, make sure no one pushes to master or main or your whatever your default branch is, or that you there should be a certain amount of reviews before a pull request is approved. So there are some tools out there that can really help you with that. And one thing I want to mention with the Git in Azure DevOps is that can also help you with your documentation. You can store pretty much anything in Git. And in this example, you see I stored some Office files in there. Now, to be clear, this does not mean I recommend to store Office files in Git, because it's not meant to use for Office files. And Office files fit better in SharePoint or OneDrive, which is meant for Office files. And Git, the way that it works with versioning is not made for Office files. My point in this is that if Office files are what is keeping you from moving to Git, store Office files in Git. I often do it myself for the documentation. If I am creating more of a product where I want to have some documentation in Word or PDFs, I want to keep them close to the code. So I store them in my Git repository. I have also seen in practice there was a situation where we were storing our scripts on SharePoint. We had a bunch of PowerShell scripts and documentation in Word files. And we weren't moving them to Git. And we were learning Git and we weren't moving them. And I asked, why don't we move these files to Git? Yeah, we first need to do something about that documentation. And it was really keeping us from going forward. So in the end, we moved all the scripts, including the Word files, to Git and made to-dos to set them off, to change them to Markdown files. So if it's keeping you, this can be done. And I tested out how far I could go with a PowerPoint presentation with videos in there. And when the file got to about 1 gig, Git stopped working pretty much. That was when it started to become unworkable. So there are some limits and it's not meant to it, but if it works for your use case, do by all means store Word files with your scripts. And here's just an example of how this would look in the web interface. So in a web interface, it looks pretty much like a file explorer, and you can see all the files and all the folders that you have here. And you see these would be some basic files that you could use, some CMDs, some PowerShell, some PowerShell scripts. You can leave everything here and then you can clone it to your local machine. So if I think about how you can get started with the repos, and I'll take that back to how you get started with Git, is the first step is to get people excited about Git. Make sure everyone knows why Git will make them happy. Because if you're already working with Git, you tend to think that it should be logical how happy Git makes you, and it can be hard to explain it to someone. So take your time to explain why Git will make someone very happy. And allow people after that to get used to Git, and that takes some time. Git is pretty complicated, and I've seen a lot that people try to explain Git and throw all these commands at someone, and it happened to me like 2 times. I had a course on Git and people were throwing at me like, you can do this and you can do that and you can do that, and I got so confused that in the end I thought, well, I'm lost, never mind, this is not for me. Until someone actually took the time to walk me through starting with it, just the basics. And I learned it along the way, and that's how it worked for me to get started with it. And I've heard that a lot from people. It can be intimidating. Git is hard to get into, and it's very worth it. So give people the time to do that. And one practical thing when you're working with repos and you are creating policies for everything, watch out for policies getting in the way of the workflow. And what I mean by that is that if your policies are too strict, and if people are finding that their work process is slowing down extensively because of policies, they are going to work around you. That's what people are going to do, and that's not what you're going to want to happen. So you need to keep in touch with everyone and see what policies work and find that middle ground. So we have now created code, and now we can move on to the build phase and the test phase, which we'll put together. Like I said, build doesn't really happen for the IT pro. But before I get into that, I want to consider the concept of pipelines, because that's what we're getting into, the pipelines. So we were at this stage with our code. We had Git for our versioning and for our backups and to work together on the scripts. But we're still deploying from our own computer. So we can still have to work with environment inconsistency. Our code reviews are all manual. Our error handling is all manual. And you miss a little piece of auditing because people are deploying from their own computer. And it can be hard to see in the real environment where something came from or who pushed something to production. So to help out with that, we can start to use pipelines. And what you can see here, you are still working in that Git repository, as are your colleagues. And from that Git repository, you can run a pipeline and that will do the deployment to you. In this case, all to Azure or to virtual machines of to on-premise environment. And from that pipeline, everything is running. That means it's always running in the same environment. So you lose that environment inconsistency. You get that backup. You can automate error handling and code review in this, and you have an auditing trail. Here I grayed out GitLab. It is possible to run it with GitLab and other providers, but if you want to run this through repos or GitHub, you can do this. It's a service within the server, so you can just sign in with your GitHub account or your Azure DevOps account and directly access your code. But it is possible to use other providers, but it's a bit more of a hassle, of course, because GitHub and Azure DevOps are both Microsoft products. So what does this look like? What we have is a build stage and a release stage, although you see those two getting back together. The release stage is still a visual way to create a pipeline where you get these steps, which you can see in the screen some examples. With a pipeline, basically what you do is run a bunch of scripts or run a bunch of tests or tasks. A pipeline always runs on an agent, which Microsoft can provide for you or which you can create yourself, which is basically a virtual machine or a container. And in that, those tasks and scripts will run like batch, like command file, but also Azure PowerShell, a regular PowerShell. And there's a marketplace full of custom tasks, which can really help you out with your development of PowerShell or of ARM templates or things like that. With the builds, we built in YAML files, which is a bit of getting used to if you're not used to it. And I will show this in a little bit, what the YAML file looks like. And you see that YAML is getting pushed more and more because you have the pipeline in code, so you can store it with your repository and duplicate it very easily. But the releases are still a visual representation, if you want to use that. Where you just click your pipeline together. So here I have an example of a test stage. So the build and test stage of infrastructure as code. These are the full tests that are available that basically test. They basically do a test for you if your template is valid. So if it's valid JSON and it won't fail on that. Pretty basic, but you can extend this. Of course, you can create your own test or make use of the what if module. There are some options to test within Azure DevOps for ARM templates, but also for Terraform and stuff like that. But this is another option. These are pester tests for a PowerShell script. And as you see, you get a nice little interface. So I have the pipeline set up to run the pester tests. So run basically invoke pester, but then in the pipeline, and it creates this interface for you where you can see completely what has passed, what has failed, and how many tests has failed, and you can see all the failing tests. So this also means you get a great fast overview of what the state of your code is and how ready it is for production. Now, with building and testing, it's pretty vague if you're not used to it, and it can take some time to get into. And I mean, the basic ARM template tests, maybe they don't take that much time. But for example, if you've never used pester, it can be a bit hard to get into. It really is something on its own. And it takes some time, and it's important to look at that return on investment, because it's going to save you a lot of time in the long run. And I noticed this myself when I was running a PowerShell module in the PowerShell gallery. Every time I needed to make a change, if I needed to change three lines, if I had to do all the testing manually, I had to look through everything in the script to check if it was still working. But I had that all automated, so I would just change the lines, run the pipelines, and know what the status of my scripts is. And if you're testing, you always do some manual testing before production, but I did not have to test every little step of the module. And it would always test more than I would think of. So take some time on this. There is a large return on investment if you notice. Make use of the assistant within the Azure DevOps portal. And I'm going to show you what I mean by the assistant. So hang on, I'm going to show it in a second. And don't stop learning about all the possibilities. And this is pretty much for all Azure DevOps and maybe all Azure, but there's always a lot going on. So it's nice to keep track of everything and keep looking out at what is all happening. So we did that build and testing. So now it's time to start our release and we're going to deploy to production. Now there are some different options available within Azure DevOps. And this is one example where I did not actually use the release step. I used multi-stage pipelines, which means that I have different stages running and I make a stage for the build and a stage for the deployment. And with this, I can do everything in YAML, which I find a lot more clean. And I think this is what most people are doing at this point. I think if people are using release at this point, it's often will be some kind of legacy. And as you can see, what I really like about this one, I made pester testing, and in the build stage, I run that pester test on Windows, Mac OS, and on Linux, which is great because I can't do that by myself because I do not have Mac OS or Linux available. I do everything on Windows, so I can't do this myself. So this gives me some extra check. For example, for this PowerShell module, I know when I first implemented these, the Linux and Mac OS build were failing. And that was because I made a mistake with capital letters somewhere, which doesn't matter in Windows, but it does matter in Mac OS and Linux. So I was happy with the test because I would never know. I had never realized it. For everyone who is a fan of Mac and Linux and is thinking, whoa, look how slow Windows is. Windows is taking a lot more time, as you can see here, but that's because on Windows, I am also running the in real life tests, as I'd like to call them, or the acceptance test. And this was a module that was doing stuff in Azure, and it actually made an Azure connection there and tested everything in one of my developer environments, but it did some real testing in there. So that's why it takes a lot longer. And after all these testing was done, I would have a step deployment, which would deploy it directly into the PowerShell gallery. And I had it set up that as soon as I deployed something to the master branch or the main branch, as soon as I did that, it would deploy to the gallery. And that made management so much more easy because it means that whatever is in my Azure DevOps is always exactly the same as what is running in production on that branch. And I can use different branches for development, but I will never have to wonder what version is the gallery at this point and what version am I running locally and am I not creating inconsistencies here. So this gave some real peace of mind when developing this module. Now, maybe you're out there thinking, well, we're not all creating stuff for the module, for the PowerShell gallery. Maybe you're creating stuff for Azure, which we'll show in a second. Or maybe you're creating stuff for an on-premise environment. This can be fine as well. You can create your own agent on an on-premise machine, which is a small piece of software that you can install and get a connection with Azure DevOps. And you can use that agent to do everything that you want to do. So, for example, if you have a script management server somewhere on premises, and what you could do on the agent is copy those files over there. So you still know that all the development is going on in the Azure DevOps environment. Everyone knows what version is there and you're doing versioning. And from there, you can set it up in the management server where it runs in scheduled tasks or any other way. So no problem. You can run this on premises without too much trouble. So to make this all visible, I want to show how it works. I put the resolution up pretty high and I'm going to see if we can see everything, because I want people to be able to read the lines, but I need to see if it will work, because this is a pretty high resolution. And here I have an example. The Azure deploy.json file with this is an ARM template with my favorite resource, a storage account. Always do storage accounts. There's a simple reason they deploy pretty quickly. This is the JSON file from the example repository from Azure. The only thing I changed is that I added a parameter for a prefix for the storage account name, which is created here. This is because I want to work with some parameters. I want some flexibility. And what I can do now, so I am here and I can click setup build to say I want to configure a pipeline, and I can use an existing YAML file if I already have one. I do not at this point, so I say give me a starter pipeline, and it creates a starter pipeline for me with a trigger, an image, and some hello world steps. Now, I will remove those hello world steps and I'm going to create a new step. I'm not going to test it ARM template. I'm just going to deploy it straight to Azure. And here I have opened the assistant and I can have all these tasks I have available. And there's actually more than I thought I have available that can help me out with deploying anything that I want to. And I start using Azure Resource Manager after order an ARM template. And I can do an ARM template deployment. And it will ask me if I want to do resource subscription or management group. I want to do in a resource group. I have created a connection already. You have to do that manually, or it can do it for you. But you have to create a service connection for Azure. I think you can get it here. Now, this is in the project settings, but I already did that. And this is my connection to Azure. And I will use my own subscription. And I can select what action I want to do. Well, I want to create or update a resource group in this one. And I have the resource group here. And I can set that location. It's almost like you're doing it in the portal. And here I can select that template. I could add parameters to that if I wanted to, but I do not have a parameter file in this case. But otherwise, I could sort here. And I can override, even if I have a parameter file, I can set parameters from here. So I'll set that prefix was close. I can set the incremental deployment mode here, and if I would use validation only, it would just check and deploy nothing. So that would be a testing phase. I'll just leave it at incremental. And I have to make sure my cursor is in the right place, and I click add. And it has created that task for me. I will look to this in a second. First, I'm going to save and run it so it can start running in the background. Save and run. And it's now creating the pipeline and starting that job. And what it did for me was create azurepipelines.jaml. So this is now stored with my code, where I can always find what is going on. It's triggered every time something is deployed to code. I can change that if I want to. This might not always work, especially when deploying resources to Azure. And here is that task that I just created. And I can even say if I would edit that. Oh, I have to edit it here. It is running at this point, but if I would edit it, I can go to settings here and get that graphical interface back. So I find this very helpful for starting working with YAML, because it can be a bit intimidating if you're starting out with it. And it has something that an IT pro is mostly not used to, that indentation matters. So the amount of spaces here matters, and it can become very frustrating, but this can really help you out. Oh, that's a shame. What did I do? I think I created it already. Ah. I did with the prefix that I set in the parameter, I used the capital letter. Let me just change that real quickly, because that's not allowed. This is one thing. I love to work with storage accounts, but I always forget that storage accounts have very bad naming options. With a storage account, you are allowed 24 characters, and it can only be small letters and numbers, nothing else. So this one failed because I had a capital letter in there. And while this is running, let me just grab my Azure portal real quickly, because I forgot that. Now what? Okay, I'm not... Oh, I did a capital letter again. Always happy to do live demos. Let's just check real quickly.
I changed it.
Oh wait, I forgot to click add. Added it, and now you can actually see it is here. And this was me being lazy. I could have changed it just here in the code. So I went lazy, and now I have to do the work twice. Let me see if it starts running now. It does get more exciting this way. And it gives me some time to start the portal on the site. So this will start running, do all those tasks for you. Now, this is the most basic pipeline that you can think of, because it has one step and one stage. You can have all these different stages and have them all connected to each other in different ways. So you can set dependencies on that, set that you only want to run a stage if another stage was successful. You can have manual improvements in between. So there's a lot of possibilities to run on. And let's just see if it's there. And here is the storage account. So that actually worked once I got the small letter. So this is just to give an example of how you can start out. And I always recommend start out like this and make it bigger as you go, because it's fun to see some results of your work. So to get started, like I said, start out small and start working on it, and play around with it. Have some fun with it. Hopefully you have some kind of demo environment where you can do that. See how those structures work and how you can connect different stages to each other, or make use of the different agents that are available to you from Microsoft where you do not even have to do anything for. So play around with it, have some fun. And a tip I want to give is to make use of the secure variables. In the pipeline, you can set variables and you have the option to store them securely so they are not visible in the pipeline or for people that use the pipeline. So if you're deploying a virtual machine and you have an administrator password, that might be a nice way to store it. Of course, you can take that further by integrating keyfold or something like that, but the secure variables are right there and can be very handy. So we've gone full circle now. And we did all the steps that we had to do for a DevOps, and we used all those resources. And I got to show everything. To put it all together, if you start using the Azure DevOps as an IT pro or just as a beginner or for the first time with your team, involve your team with everything. So you can set up some stuff on your own and introduce it to your team, but your team is going to have to use it. So involve them in why choices are made and what you're going to do. And I recommend really to just try stuff and adapt to the stuff that's not working. So maybe you can try working with some stuff and then evaluate after 2 weeks or after a month, say, what is working for us, what is not working, what is frustrating us, and how can we fix it? And one that I think is very important is to make Azure DevOps work for you. You can take a lot of time thinking about how you're going to use Azure DevOps right. But if it works for you, then you're doing it right. And if you're not doing it right, you will find out at some point or another because it's not going to work for you. But if your use case is something else than what the documentation expects or what people tell you to do, if it works for you, it's fine. It's a nice tool to adapt to your own situation and make it work for you. So we have just now created a free Azure DevOps subscription and you want to get started and get going with it. The first thing, the resource I want to give you is dev.azure.com, where you can create that resource. The Microsoft docs are very extensive on Azure DevOps. There's a lot of the practical documentation on how to do stuff, but there's also a lot of documentation on strategy and on how you can shape Azure DevOps for your needs and what DevOps is and how you can start using it. So a really good resource. I want to mention Microsoft Learn. There are now actually some very cool Azure DevOps resources. It is a great resource for anything Azure whatsoever. And what you can do with Microsoft Learn is you get a module where you focus on a subject, you get some theory, and then you get some practice. So you get to do stuff and work with it. And in the end, you get points, and then you can level up. So that's cool as well. There are also some modules on, for example, starting with ARM templates or working with PowerShell, stuff like that. So Microsoft Learn is really a great resource. And I want to promote myself a little bit for my blog, Forbes.nl. I have created some blog posts on creating your first pipeline, creating your first service connection, what steps you can do to create, to test your ARM templates, stuff like that. I have tried my best. Oh, and I have some blog posts on how to get started with Git and PowerShell. I tried my best to make some approachable blog posts about that. So you can check Forbes with a 4.nl. And on the sidebar, you can choose category Azure DevOps. You get pretty much any of them. And that's it for me. Nice. So,
Yeah. Thank you, Barbara. I think we managed to solve it with the sound and all. There's actually no questions. There was just some comments when you asked about IT pros and admin or devs. I think we had two IT pros and one that is both an IT admin and actually two, that's IT admin and pros. So yeah, it's a good topic. I had a question myself to you. You said that you started using the the pipelines in YAML, and you switched in between to get the syntax of the YAML files correctly. How long did it take for you to feel comfortable with YAML?
Well, when I started out with Azure DevOps, it was the visual interface was a lot more visible. And there was actually a visual interface for the build steps, and that's completely gone now. So it was normal then to start out with the visual interface. And with those visual steps that you had, there was like a general YAML generator in it. So you could click a button and it showed you the YAML that you had created. And that really helped me get into it. And I got into it pretty quickly because there's a pretty clear use case, because I found myself documenting our visual pipelines so that all the repositories were using the same pipelines, which takes a lot of time, and every time you have to click through it again. So the use case for YAML, if you're working in a larger environment, is so clear that this can really motivate you to keep going with it. And you're going to get very frustrated because of the indentation and you're getting it wrong somewhere. But once you get the hang of it, it is pretty satisfying to see your complete pipeline take place and find that way to work. Yeah. And then you can have a complete, in the end, you can even have a repository just for your YAML files so that you have some consistency in there and stuff like that. So it really outweighs the visual interface, in my opinion.
So there's a small learning curve, but it will pay.
Yeah.
Pay in the end. we're trying to do like this. Yes. So there's no other questions actually, but you feel free to, if you have the live stream up, to paste any links in the chat there. I think it will help the attendees to find the resources if you have them. And while you do that, I will share my my presentation again. And with that, I will.
I will say I see that someone, when I asked if you're a developer or an IT pro, that someone answered both. That's my answer always. My answer is always both.
Perfect. So, to close off, I just want to thank our sponsors again. Remind you to claim your badge. I also posted a link in the chat, so you can grab it from there. And next time we'll do something is in 1st of December. So please join that. It will probably be in the same format as this one. And keep an eye out on the meetup for upcoming events. We have some hands-on and skill-up sessions planned. And that's kind of all of us, all from us this time. And Barbara, big thanks again for doing the presentation for us.
Very welcome.